Good. So our next speaker will be Lourdes Prades, who is the responsible for one of the most important archives connected to the International Brigades. She will present a project called SIDBRINT, which is an IT system that is collecting all the information on the International Brigades. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I will now switch to Spanish because I am going to Albacete on Sunday, so I will start practicing Spanish. Good. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My first slide shows the Republic Pavilion, which is the library that I'm working in, along with a great team of librarians and history experts. We conduct a task at this library that is studying the Second Republic, the Civil War, exile, Franquism, the transition. I just wanted to show you the place I work so that you become jealous of me. Okay, let me present the project now. This SIDBRINT project was born when a group of volunteers, history experts, archivists, librarians, and people from other backgrounds decided to study this this topic, because basically at the center, the headquarters is at the Republic Pavilion, so we have a team of librarians and historians together. We're rather dangerous when we're put together. And when we defined the scope of the project, we had a clear idea of what we wanted to do. We wanted to study the history, not of the International Brigades, because that has been done. There are many specialists who have been researching in depth that, but we wanted to have a story of the people behind the International Brigades, brigaders, and we really wanted to explore who they were, all these people who came to Spain to fight in favor of democracy. As I said, we're historians, but also librarians, and we work with documental sources. This is the basic source that we have. So, when we devised this project, the SIDBRINT project, we wanted to know how many they were, who were they, how were they organized, how come they came to Spain, and how did they do it. So we said, okay, we want to find out who brigaders were, but where will we get this information? Okay, from sources, books, press, archives, audiovisual material, images, web resources. I will show you a sample of how we work with each of these documents. And what were we trying to obtain? We were trying to build a story. And of course, we did a brainstorming process. But then we started working with document sources. But then what were we trying to find out? The country of origin, we wanted to know the job they had, their profession, because this is interesting and this is how we can understand why they were doing one thing or another. We want to know what are the battles and fronts they were fighting in. And then we also want to know the nicknames of these brigadiers, because it's true that the same brigadier can have up to 10 different type of nicknames. And we are archivists, and we know how to work with this and unify all these nicknames. And of course, we wanted to know the political affiliations. And it's also interesting to find out what happened with these brigaders after the war ended. Those who left the country, we want to know whether they were in a concentration camp, if they fought in the Second World War, if they came back to Russia, if they were Soviet. This is the information that we're trying to collect from the sources that we analyze. What do we have in SIDBRINT? We have over 23,700 brigaders, and I'm going to qualify them because this is clear. We have 23,700 documented brigader. That means that at least we have one source that is documenting it, showing it. If a brigader has no source, call us, because this is impossible. We really want to reach the figure of 35,000 or 40,000, because is this what the literature says is the real figure of brigaders. But according to our sources, right now we have over 1,700 different sources. And when I say sources, they may seem small, but when I talk about the Soviet archive, this is considered just one single source, but then a magazine, it's just the name of a magazine or the Soviet archive. But of course, we have reviewed all the different items in the Soviet archive, for example. When we were trying to find out who could be a part of our database, we started discussing, okay, brigaders, only members of the international brigades. No, we wanted to include in our database all the international volunteers, all the foreigners who came to Spain to fight. This is why we included advisors, observers, journalists, correspondents, collaborators, friends, or even translators, interpreters, and so on and so forth. And I'm saying this because when you check our database, you shouldn't tell us that, oh, this was not a soldier, he was an advisor. Of course, we are including this type of people. What else is in our data, in our database? We have the battalion or the companies that brigaders would belong to. And for people who are not used to this topic, it was difficult to get familiar with a different battalion. So we created a sort of Wikipedia with all the brigades and their composition and a short description of each. What else do we include in our database? We have full text documentation. That is, when we have the license, when we have the permit to include this in the website, some of these documents are included fully in our database. And of course, we also include all these type of topic matters, like big topics and subtopics, so that everything can be indexed and so that search can be conducted in a proper way. Let me please show you a short sample of material that we use for our database. This is books and leaflets. In as far as books are concerned, of course, memories are interesting. We have references with a different book, for example, with Hans Beiger. But then we have the content list. We do a process whereby we extract all the information from the list of content, and we also use the press, the inter-brigader press, with all the papers published on brigaders, all the papers that give information on the international brigades with a list of members. This is also a part of our database. Personal information. We have a lot of personal information. From the moment we start working with the project, we are starting to collect even more info, because there are many family members of brigaders and people belonging to associations who come to us, write to us, and it's very moving, because it's a human story. It gets really touching, really, really moving. One of the speakers, I met her because she came to explain the story of her grandfather, who was a brigader. So this is creating very strong emotional bonds. There are some curious things that we also like to document, such as list of those wounded and death, or people admitted to hospitals, for example. Our colleague from Albacete is working with the cemetery, for example. The people in Mataró are also working with the cemetery of Mataró and the list of hospitals admissions. And I always explain this anecdote because it's quite funny. One day, Dutchman called us from the Holland Institute, and they said that we have flags in Barcelona with brigaders. And do you know that? And I did not know. And then I called a person at the synagogue asking for these flags. And then we could see those flags in the, at the Barcelona synagogue. In the main synagogue of Barcelona, there was a plaque, and I didn't know about it. It was thanks to a Dutchman that I found out. We also use websites as sources. The Uruguayan website, for example, is pretty useful because we can see the members of the International Brigades, the Abraham Lincoln Archives, Marx Memorial. We went to Amsterdam, too. And we were getting all the information there. We have agreements with Canada, for example, with Canada Spanish Civil War, to get their website into our database. We're really strict. And when we're using information from another institution, we always introduce the information we need, but the source, the reference, always belongs to the institute that, or to the association that we have used. We just give a reference. We will not repeat the tasks or the job that they did so excellently well. And then we have the best thing, which is the Soviet archive. The Soviet archive is now online. And when you start working with the Soviet archive, you realize how great it is. It's like a drug. It's an obsession. I remember I went to the presentation of a book, and at the end of the presentation, there was a man who said, I'm working with the Soviet archive. And back then, it was like an anonymous alcoholic association meeting, because we were so excited. I recommend you to check the Soviet archive, because it includes so many things, but it's really time-consuming at the same time. Let me show you something else. These are excerpts from letters and emails sent to us by people regarding this project, and this is becoming more and more important. For example, this person, Ulrich, who's a historian working on a big project on the resistance against the National Socialism in Köln. So it was a professor at a university offering us the possibility to collaborate. And then we also have Dr. Radim Gonda from the Czech Republic, who wants to participate and collaborate with us. I did not make it up. Those are real testimonials. We have another one here, for example.
For example, Professor Garrido at the Polytechnic, his father was a brigadier, a brigadier, and we've been in touch. We know each other, and he keeps sending me information because people love his relative to be in the database, and they keep sending you information. For example, hey, this person said, he's not a seller, he was a shoemaker or a shoe seller. Well, I don't have the scriptor for a shoe seller, whatever. So it's wonderful for people to participate and being so interested. People love it, really. Or, for example, this lady who, this was sent by my colleagues of the Exile Museum at the Junquera in the French-Spanish border. And she wanted to know about his grandfather who participated in the Telman Battalion. Another project, I would like you to show a demo, but not really. I'm going to just forget it, because most of you know how SIDBRINT works. Bad news, it should have been done for today, but the IT company didn't have it on time, so we will, hopefully, we will enjoy a new SIDBRINT website very soon. But I can show you a few slides of how it's going to look like. And us being superheroes, because we never stop working, we thought, right, this works. But we would like to know whether this works, because if we know, we know how it works. But we did some user test studies. Actually, there's a lady who's going to do her PhD soon in Salamanca. And she's worked in SIDBRINT's user experience. And Marta, this researcher who had helped us do a practicum during her studies, realized people actually accessed our portal and said, where do I begin from? So all this has been written down. And Marta, from this user experiences and usability tests, has helped us improve what was going wrong, what didn't work. So it's great, very important. Also, we want to develop some humanital digital geolocalization information on the brigaders. And all this information we've gathered, you know, we could actually build up a map, so knowing where he departs from his city of origin, what sort of parkour, what sort of path he follows, where did he fight in Spain, etc., etc. So all this research information, the new website allows us. But before you had your search done, but afterwards you couldn't export it, you couldn't work with it. So we've taken this into consideration and we're going to improve this. And here, I'm going to show you here in gray the old website and the new one. What we ask for the company is that people should recognize. We want people to realize that we've implemented a few things, but we wanted to keep its main identity. Right. We have improved, indeed, in its design, because we were telling them what we wanted as for the surfing experience, the user experience. It's not online yet, so I need to tell you about, for example, the search option. Before you search for Telman, and you had a long list of information because it searched in any part of its actual document of that person. But if you looked for Telman as a surname, you had 2,000 results units. So now you can do an advanced search so that you can see this should be in the field of surname, or this should be within the framework of a battalion or the International Brigade, etc. Also in the search box, in the new one, it will work like Google. You will not end up writing the brigadier name, and it will suggest you. We have three options. Which one do you want? So now if you don't type in the exact surname, you don't get a result. Also, we've improved the visibility with regards to social networks and news. Now it's not necessary to join any specific social network, but at the bottom of the page you will have all possibilities and all news that have been published in any social network. Also, subjects. We realized that people were struggling what type of matters or topics they could select for their search. So we created what we call this cloud of words, so we can create this sort of labeled or specific search. This type of search is you telling, right, I want brigaders from the Battle of the Ebro River, or having to do with hospitals and women. So this substructure helps you create a much more specific search. And then when it comes to data export, researchers realized that it's very interesting that when they have the result of that search, they can actually work with it and they can export it into a more usable Excel file, for example, or any editable file, because they can create a PDF file afterwards, for example. So we've taken that into consideration. And also the search criteria are much more user-friendly. Also, after this faceted search, let me tell you about the specific dossier or file for each person. It tells where he or she was born, how many years he or she spent in Spain, to which battalion he or she belonged to. And then we realized this specific document for each person was too overcrowded with information. So we've divided it in two tabs. One has to do with all the information of this brigader, where he or she was born, other names he or she was known for, how many years this person spent in Spain, and then another tab nearby with all the information that have to do with the sources mentioning this person. And of course, because we are such great librarians, we actually specify the page of that specific source or that URL. We give you all sorts of detailed information. Also, we've improved the page. Remember, I told you we created a Wikipedia on each battalion, brigade, etc. So now we have a pop-up implemented. So if you have that specific brigader page open, if you want to know all about a specific battalion, that extra parallel information will pop up, but you will not lose the main brigader page. Okay? Right, so as I've told you, we're present in Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. And this is all. Thank you very much.